Welcome back. So I went and I saw the movie If tonight, which is about imaginary friends. And I brought when I met Yvonne, and I talked to her about beloved toys I had when I was a kid. And there was one stuffed animal I took carried with me when I was at home. It was pretty much for me, it was like Linus's security blanket. Didn't leave the house though, obviously. I didn't want to look crazy, but I did have imaginary friends when I was a kid. That movie really spoke to me. And so, this my wife got for me after I think it was the second year we were together. She found this on eBay. And these are hard to find. Now, back in the 70s, there were a lot of these. The one that I had had a red and yellow hat on it, it had red and yellow suspenders and pants. The shoes were a little bit different on it as well. And I had my initials on the bottom of it as well. So sort of like, Woody and Toy Story and all that. Now the jersey, of course, I had to get him the jersey because it has to be Canucks. So anybody who thinks, yeah, but does he really cheer for the Canucks? My stuffed animal has a Canucks jersey. I do not have another infant-sized jersey for my stuffed animal. But the movie is good. If you haven't seen it, I really enjoyed it. It spoke more to me than it did to Yvonne. I had initially planned on doing a review with the both of us, but I feel like this movie was really, really personal to me. I've talked in videos before about my childhood and about like when I did the my life story stuff. And this is sort of in that vein. We lived in a trailer that was, I think it was 12 feet by 60 feet. It might even have been 10 feet by 60 feet. Like it was tiny. My bedroom was at the back, but again, you're never very far from anybody in the trailer. My parents had arguments. My dad was a heavy drinker, and he would come home and the fights would start. And of course, when you're in a trailer park, and I mean those walls are tin. Everybody in the neighborhood knows. So then I'm out the next day and like people are, talking to me and I see that look in their eyes like, is Shannon okay? I'm fine, please stop. But the refuge that I had was those imaginary friends. Remember, I was an only child. I didn't have anybody to talk to. I was socially awkward, still am, spoiler alert. And so for me, that kind of kept me alive. It kind of kept me going. And there were some bad days where I would go to school and have a really hard time in school because again, socially awkward, getting picked on, and then going home and not a great home situation either. The only refuge I had was really here, was what my mind could come up with. And I would come up with elaborate stories. At one point in time, when I was, I think I was 23, 24, I decided to write out that as a novel, and I called it Wonderful World. I have not rewritten it. What ended up happening was I started dating my ex. She read the book. Like, I was really proud of it. I was like, I think this is the best thing I've ever written. I think this is great. And she was not a fan of it. She came out of it thinking I was crazy. She was in tears when I came home. She was like right up in my face about it. And I'm like, no, I know it's fiction, it's clearly a work of fiction. I'm not saying any of that was real, just for the book. I had to make it, if it was real, here's, and obviously I changed names and everything. But that experience kind of soured me on it. I never went back to it. I could go back to the sci-fi. I could write thrillers here and there, sure, but I felt like that book, and again, I called it Wonderful World. I felt like I couldn't do it again. Coming out of that movie, it reminded me of this. There's this magic innocence that you have as a kid, and once that's gone, it's hard to get it back. And I think that was a big arching message of the movie, and maybe it's just me and my experience, and I'm imprinting on the movie what I took out of it, and maybe that wasn't even the message of the movie. I know that there's people who are mad that certain movies aren't doing very well right now. I would say this, Mad Max is a niche audience. It's never been a big budget, mega blockbuster type thing. They spent way too much money in that movie. This movie is, I think, going to do very well this summer. It's a family movie. There's nothing gross in it. It's just a sweet story, and there's a twist at the end. I'm not ruining it for anybody. Don't worry, I'm not spoiling anything. But I did not see the twist coming until about 5 minutes before the reveal. It suddenly hit me, and I went, "Oh wow, okay, all right then, all right." I had a concern at one point because I've seen so many movies where something magical is actually something bad. I had these bad visions in my head that this little girl was seeing all these imaginary friends because she had a brain tumor. And I hate to say this, it's like I have seen so many movies where something magical's happening, and then oh no, actually they're dying. And I'm really happy to tell you that's not the case. So if you're waiting for this really heavy moment, there are a couple of heavy-ish moments, but it's really not too bad. I thought it was well written. There's some pacing issues at times. I know Gabriel said it felt like it was over 2 hours, and I said, nope, the movie's not 2 hours. I would not go to a movie that's over 2 hours long on my first night off without hockey in a while. But that was kind of perfect. That was kind of exactly what I needed. So I don't really have time to write. I've thought about like hiring a ghostwriter. I've thought about like dictating my book, like using voice recorder and all that. Because I really think Wonderful World would be an interesting novel to write. And now that I'm 25 years, 26 years older than I was the last time I touched that book, I would have a completely different perspective now. So if I was writing about it with like these imaginary friends, I would probably start the book with me at my age, still with them still being a part of my life, and then throw it back to when I was a kid and then go stage by stage through, and just sprinkle in real incidents with some made up incidents and leave it to the reader to kind of think about which ones might be real and which ones aren't. But that was exactly what I needed. That was like the whole inner child. It gets into every, it just, it really, it got me. There were a few moments that got me, and I was even like, man, I don't know why I'm getting emotional, but on some level it was because I'd been through that. And there's a moment too where a character that has been stressed, when the source of that stress disappears, so does the imaginary friend. And I thought, that's how that works. That for me, and it was the monkey here was Michael Monkey, and this is not Michael. No offense to this wonderful stuffed animal here that my wife spent a good deal of money to find for me. I have looked for the one with the yellow and red hat. I have looked many times over on eBay. I can't find it. It is one of those things that's worth. It is my rosebud. It is absolute. That's it. That's the someday on my deathbed, I will say Michael. I'd be like, why is he saying Michael? But gotta be Buble. It's not Buble. It's this. It's what that represents. It's what that got me through. It's that, I've struggled with depression even when I was a little kid, and I could never figure out what it was. I could never figure out what the problem was. That I would just, I remember there was one time, I was maybe three, and I was just crying in the middle of the night. No idea why. No idea why. My mom came in, do you want a glass of water? And I said, yes. She got me a glass of water, and I was able to go back to sleep. All I knew was I was sad and I was crying. And those were the times where that relief that your brain can provide you by giving you that place, right? Like a Pan's Labyrinth, the little girl in Pan's Labyrinth, which is a really sad movie if you haven't seen it. If you haven't seen it, go watch it. It's a fantastic movie. But yeah, and this one too, I identified with this so much. I just, yeah, it was something. So I'm gonna bet dollars to donuts that John Krasinski's had imaginary friends in his life. I don't think you can write that without having had some experience with that. I know most kids have. But there's a scene in the movie too where it's really elaborate. It's this really elaborate fantasy sequence. And in the back of my mind, I was like, that's what I pictured. This kind of thing is what I pictured when I would let my imagination run wild, because my parents are yelling and screaming 15 feet away from me. So I use stuffed animals, I use whatever I need to surround myself and to escape from that situation and pretend I'm not there, pretend I'm not experiencing that, and to toughen myself up a little bit. And just, it worked. It always worked. When I was a kid, my mother always said that the worst thing you could do to me was kick me out of the house. Don't ground me. Why ground me? Kick me out of the house. I didn't like being outside. And it had nothing to do with electronics, because we didn't have all the electronics kids do now. It was that in my room, that was my sanctuary. That's where I had all of those escapes, all of those little things. My record player was part of my escape too. I could put music on. I could not go out and argue with my parents. I could not go out and tell them to stop, but I could play music loud enough that they knew I could hear them and that I was still up. And sometimes it stopped the fight. Sometimes it helped. So, yeah, that movie's brought a lot back. That movie brought a lot back for me tonight. It's kind of just this flood of stuff. So glad there wasn't a hockey game for me to watch after watching the movie, because I don't know if I could concentrate on all the minutiae that I usually concentrate on with an NHL game. And yeah, just I really, really enjoy. I thought it was a fun movie. I know the reviews haven't been great for it. I don't care. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was good. I thought you could have focused the story a little bit better. Maybe you could have dropped a few characters. Steve Carell's voicing of the big purple guy, it was I like, and there were moments where I really wanted to like the character, and I thought he was interesting at points, but in general, yeah. But they do show like these imaginary friends bonding with people, and it's touching. It is, because you can see that, like, I don't know, like, and I think this is part of the reason why religion is so prominent and why there are so many people who believe in things we can't see, because life's a little more magical that way. There's definitely something more magical when you believe in all this stuff and when you indulge in that part of your brain, right? And sometimes maybe I get a little too analytical and not as whimsical as I used to. So I'm gonna have to find the time. I'm gonna have to find the time to write it. I've wanted to even hire a ghostwriter. I've thought about doing that. I looked into it at one point. A, it ends up being pretty darn expensive considering I don't even have a publisher. And B, time. I don't want to be taking time away from Yvonne. When I'm already during the regular season, she barely sees me. She started seeing me over the last month and a half with the playoffs whittling down. So, yeah, I wouldn't want to then in the off season go, all right, now I'm going to write a book and just be doing that all day. But man, there's so much that movie kind of unlocked, and it is interesting to me that I've had those experiences more, I think, now that I'm self-employed and I'm home a lot. Because when I had the mindless job working on an assembly line, hey, you just zone out all day, you sing music to yourself, you chat with the person next to you if you like them, or you ignore them if you don't, and you start singing again, because it makes a move further away if you're singing. Especially if you're singing like, I wish I were an Oscar Mayer Wiener, people don't understand why you're singing it, but they know they don't want to be next to you while you do. And so, like, I don't know. I feel like I'm in a better place to really tap into that side of myself. And the movie was excellent. I thought. I know that Yvonne didn't like it as much as I did. I know that they're like halfway through the movie, I said, are you enjoying this? And she went, eh, like that. So I know I know she wasn't enjoying it nearly as much as I was, but she never had an imaginary friend as a kid. She didn't have one. So I think it definitely will appeal to you more if you've had one as a kid. If you haven't, yeah. Yeah, because there's that whimsy, that creativity, that pure creativity. I thought what was nice in it too was that the imaginary friends. Now, I understand that like licensing is expensive, so that's why none of them were like Mickey Mouse or anything. But I thought it was nice that they were generic, because usually when you've got an imaginary friend as a kid, it's not based on a movie, it's not based on a TV show, it's not. It is something that you've created that's your own. It is, and it is, you know that your confidence won't be broken, that your secrets won't get out. I could really say the darkest thoughts that were in my mind when I had an imaginary friend, and know that my imaginary friend's not going to betray me with it, right? And sometimes by saying things out loud and hearing myself say them, I'd be like, man, I got to get this together. You know, this dark cloud that's hanging over me, I've got to do what I can to get rid of it. And yeah, it was hard at times. And I that movie really brought a lot of that back. I'm not sure when it's technically set. So one thing with this movie was nobody had a cell phone. And the music in it was Tina Turner's Better Be Good to Me. I saw record players. I didn't see even a cassette deck. I didn't see a CD. So I think this is supposed to be set in the late 80s, early 90s. There's a camcorder, which tells me probably mid 90s because it was smaller than the ones we had in the 80s, the big hurricane ones that'd kill your shoulder. But yeah, it's and I think I was primed for this too because I've been watching Disneyland walkthroughs from the 80s and seeing what people are wearing, and go watch those and look for anybody wearing bright neon crap. We did not wear that in the 80s. Everything was denim, everything was plaid. There were a lot of print t-shirts. We wore a lot of because we had the t-shirt shop at the end of the street where you'd go in and I want that pattern on that color of a t-shirt, and you'd come back in an hour and it's done. They print the shirt out for you and you're done. And yeah, the 80s were not quite what they're portrayed as sometimes, and on TV too. Sometimes on the Goldbergs, when I see things, I'm like, we didn't really all dress like that in the 80s. Some did, sure, but not for that long. Like the neon fad, the way I remembered it was actually 90 that was the neon fad, 1990 and 91. And then when I finally started getting neon clothes to catch up, everybody had stopped wearing them. So that was fun. But you know, this movie too, I think underlines and underscores why I've made the decision to go to Disneyland this summer. That inner child, that, you know, feeling like a kid again, you can do that there. You can feel like a kid again. And I think that's valuable. I think that's important. I think it's important to stay in touch with who you used to be, so it's easier to deal with who you are now and to figure out, you know, how to fix things that you might not be happy with about yourself now. Certainly, I have plenty of things that I may not be entirely happy with about myself now. But that was something. So when that comes out on streaming, I'm definitely gonna get it. And that's a movie I'm gonna watch probably a lot, because now that I and again, I'm not giving any spoilers. Now I know the twist at the end, I need to watch it from the start again. And it will feel completely different the next time I watch it. Yeah, I just it was fun. It was really, really fun. It's not a laugh out loud funny movie. It's not like I know the kids enjoyed it. I know the kids enjoyed it. Adelaide thought it was great, but Adelaide's about the same age as the little girl in the movie, so that helped. And it's cute. Sometimes a movie can just be cute, and I really am starting to get irritated with movie reviewers that you can tell they're going into a movie looking for ways to find fault. There are a lot of YouTubers that watching TV shows clearly just watch them to find fault. You know, I watched this week's Doctor Who and absolutely loved it. I thought it was great. And then online, it's just all these people just crapping on it. And that's part of the reason why, even though those don't get views, I make sure that I'm putting out reviews for the Doctor Who episodes because I'm really liking this season of Doctor Who. And it just feels like it is far more popular now just to crap on everything. Just like, nah, this isn't any good. This doesn't make any logical sense. It's a show about a 2,000-year-old Time Lord who gets in a police box that's infinitely big on the inside. And you're looking for logical truth and just a coherent all the way through. Like I don't know where to go with that. And I really feel bad for writers right now because it does feel like no matter what you write, it's gonna be given that thumbs down until, oh, this isn't good enough. Nah, this isn't as good as Oppenheimer. Oppenheimer was quite good. And I haven't seen Oppenheimer, to be honest, because it's 3 hours, and I'm like, yeah. But you can't, and I've said this about horror movies, you can't take every single movie and grade it the same. You can't take every TV show and grade it the same. They're not all the same. It's like music. Every genre of music. You might love country music. I don't. I love metal. You might not. Everybody's tastes are different, but which is fine. But like when I see some of these movie or TV reviews, and oh, this isn't any good because, and I'm thinking, well, no, it's not that it's not good. It's you didn't like it because. It doesn't mean it wasn't good. And I think that's part of the problem now, is that people go in looking for fault. And they decide, I didn't think this was great because, or they look for, is there a social message in here I don't like? And I've seen people complaining about this and that, and some of these shows I watch, and I'm like, I didn't see that at all. Because again, I think people are just predisposed to looking for fault and looking for a reason not to like things. And I don't like to do that. I generally don't like to do that. It's why on the hockey channel, I try to stay out of negativity, like talking about this player sucks and this contract sucks and this is stupid. I don't want to do that. I feel like there's so much negativity. The entire internet's got the corner on negativity. I want them to stay on that corner, and I want to be not necessarily positive all the time, because that'd get irritating, but at least try to have some balance to it, and not just go into all that negative awfulness that I see so often. Even here on the platform, I've lost count of how many times I look at a thumbnail and see the title of a video, and I'm like, oh, here we go. Another person that thinks they're crusading to fix what's wrong with Hollywood or fix what's wrong with television. Why? Why? There's so much content out there. Just consume the other content. If you don't like it, you don't have to whine and complain and get everybody else to whine and complain. Just don't watch it, and it'll solve itself. If enough people don't watch it, it goes away. So, anyways, thank you guys so much for your time, for your attention, and there's no shame in having those escapes. There's no shame in talking to yourself. There's no shame in having an imaginary friend if that's what keeps you sane. If just that little bit of insanity keeps you sane, perfectly fine. And I did wear the Deadpool jersey because it's Ryan Reynolds in the movie. I felt like I gotta wear it. I gotta wear it because Ryan Reynolds in the movie. I think there were three other people in the theater other than us. But it's a Monday, and it was the middle showing on a Monday, so I know the movie has not performed as well as people had hoped, but movie viewing has changed. It's absolutely changed, and it's just the new reality. The budgets have to come down. You don't need to spend $165 million on a Mad Max prequel that doesn't have Mad Max in it. Why did this movie flop? I don't know. It's a Mad Max movie without Mad Max. I'm not saying that as an insult to Furiosa at all. But if you want to get people to go and see it, having a Mad Max movie without Mad Max, it's obviously not going to have that same resonance with your general audience, even though all the reviews I've seen for the movie are positive. So, but I want to say this too. I was not a fan of Mad Max Fury Road. I thought it was entirely too long. And when the chase through the desert stopped at the one end, I was like, okay, good. All right. Well, that was okay. And then we got to go back. Oh, don't go back. Please don't go back. Oh my God, they're going back. Oh no, this movie's like half over. Oh no. And that gave me like some PTSD. And that's a movie that most people absolutely love. And I was just like, I don't enjoy this. This is way too long. So again, different tastes, but have I ever said it's a bad movie? No, it's a good movie. It was too long for me. And I tuned out. The second half of the movie, I was like, I'm done. I am so beyond done. Yeah, it was hard for me to get concerned, any of it. But that's me. Everybody's tastes are different. And that's fine. So, thank you guys so much for your attention and for your time. If I had to grade the movie I watched tonight, and I keep touching this stuffed animal. He has to go up on the set, though, doesn't he? He kind of has to now, doesn't he? But yeah, if I had to grade this movie, if I was going to grade it on a letter grade, I'd give it a solid B plus. It's not an A movie. If the tone was a little more consistent, if some of the storylines felt rushed, and you'll know if you've watched it what I'm talking about, where there's certain scenes that end and they feel incomplete. And I'm like, wait a minute, there's more to film there. What happened? So I'll be interested to see if when it comes out on streaming, if there's an extended edition, because I have a feeling that some of those scenes might have got cut for time. I hope so. Because again, there were certain moments that it was just jarring, where you're in a scene and then all of a sudden, wait, what happened? It's the next day. Why is it the next day? What happened back there? But hey, you know, I know the end, the very end of the movie kind of clears it up, but at the time you're kind of like, wait, what happened there? That just, you just, and then you go to the next scene, but I want to know what happened at the end of that. Because it seems like it's a really important moment, and it's over, and there's no resolution. So, anyways, there you go. Thank you guys so much for all your support, though. It does mean a ton. It means a lot. I am very, very grateful, very, very humbled by the success both channels have had. And thank you guys for your support. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe if you haven't done so already. Thank you guys so much for watching. And never, never be afraid to admit that we all need to go a little bit insane at times to stay sane for all the rest of the time. I will talk to you again soon.